We are gathered here today to mourn the loss of Rendog, who died like a freaking noob while staring at the moon. We are also gathered here today, and this is kind of awkward, to mourn the loss of Rendog once again, who died twice like a noob building the Mob Castle towers. May his souls rest in pieces.
Greetings, cyberdogs and citizens of the internet, and welcome back to another episode of Let's Play Minecraft Survival with me, Ren Diggity Dog. In the previous episode, we went on a sweet-ass grand tour of our Minecraft Survival world, and in this episode, my friends, we're going to be doing a little bit of work on one of our major projects for season number 4, and that is the Mob Spawner Castle that you can see behind me. Currently, it looks like a giant ass elephant surrounded by stone brick towers, and it is butt freaking ugly, and we need to do a little bit of work to make this place look awesome. And guys, I got some news for you. I think I've got some designs for this place that are going to blow your freaking minds. I hope you got a tasty ass beverage. I do hope you got some crunchy ass snacks right now, because you know what, my friends, it is time to play some Minecraft Survival. Well, my friends, here we are back at the Mob Spawner Trap Castle thingy that is currently known as the Giant Ugly Elephant. And I know what you guys are saying, because I can hear you right through the internet. You're saying, Rendog, it looks like you've done a ton of work here without us. What in the jazz? How could you leave us out, you bastard? Well, my friends, just before I left for Gamescom last weekend, I spent a good couple of hours just playing on my Minecraft Survival world. And yes, I have made a lot of progress without you. And let me try and explain myself why. A lot of you guys in the comments of episode 48 and 49 were saying, Rendog, I've lost faith in your ass. That freaking mob castle that you are making looks so freaking ugly right now that I can barely look at it. It is a giant bit of cobblestone towerage surrounded by stone towers or stone brick towers that all look exactly the same, and it is looking janky as hell. And you know what, guys? I read those comments and they made me cry a little bit. I was welling up inside, man. I was like, my cyber dogs have lost faith in me. I need to get it back, and I need to spend a little bit of time making this place look beautiful before the next episode. And I think that you guys will agree that this place is starting to look freaking sweet. Damn! Let me take you through some of the improvements that I have done to this place. Firstly, I started working on the mob delivery tube. If you guys remember, this is basically the new butthole that we have over here. And there is a zombie spawner underneath here that is delivering zombies into this pit via some aqueducts that run underground. And those zombies are dropping down this 23 high drop chute above us. And they are landing right about here in this position. And as you can see, I've created a really, really cool little trap area using some nether brick and some polished andesite. Oops, that is my bad. And I think it is looking absolutely glorious. And the way to get up here is to come up these stairs that I've made out of nether bricks. And you know what? I really, really like the combination of blocks that I'm currently using in this build. Let me try and break it down for you what I've been doing in here. Now, the first thing that I started working on was trying to find a better design for the towers, for the four towers that surround the mob trap over here. And what I figured out was something that is actually disturbing my OCD, something fierce. You see, we are using the John Smith texture pack in this series, and for the very first time in 351 episodes of Minecraft Survival, I have come to realize that we have got a little bit of a problem in the John Smith texture pack. Let me try and show you guys, man. If we put a bit of cobblestone next to the stone brick, it is looking ridiculously ugly. I mean, how disgusting does that look? The cobblestone has a little bit of green tint to it, I think, or it looks like it has a bit of green to it. And the stone brick color is very, very faded and very, very dull. And these two just do not match very well. That means that I have been finding it extremely difficult to find blocks that actually match with these stone bricks that we got going on over here. So I've had to try a little bit of a different approach to getting some more color and stuff into this build. And what I've done is try to use more polished andesite, cobblestone stairs, iron fences, and of course, this a beautiful netherrack over here. Now, let's take a quick gander at the floor of the first level of the mob castle. And as you guys can see, I've been doing a little bit of a mix match between polished andesite, polished diorite, and even a little bit of, light gray stained clay. Look at that, baby. Just breaking up the texture a little bit with that light gray stained clay. And as you can see, this floor, I think, looks sufficiently evil and sufficiently weird for what I'm trying to achieve in the mob spawner castle over here. Of course, this is a facility where we murder the undead, and so it does need to have a little bit of a weird, a mad professor castle thing going on. And I think that I've achieved it with this combination of colors, using these sort of, almost like a chessboard design for the floor, and then using dark oak wood logs, which I think looks really, really awesome, to bring a little bit of more of an evil wood feel into the build. Now, the dark oak wood logs next to the netherrack, I think, work really, really nicely together. And then, of course, we have these dark iron fences. The color, I mean, is very dark. And that just kind of adds to the whole mad professor feel of this place. And I am really, really digging it right now. I really like the way this place has come out. I hope you guys like it too, man. I think it's looking pretty damn sweet. Now, what are we going to be doing in today's episode? We've got a couple of things to do. I want to finish off the floor of the first floor of this castle, and I also want to finish off the floor of the second floor of the castle. You guys can see that I've already done a little bit of work over here. I've been adding a second story to the place, looking kind of sweet, but I want to finish off this floor before we actually move on onto anything else today. So let me get cracking with that. I'll bring you back in a second and we will carry on chatting. Do you guys want to know what one of the craziest things about Minecraft is for me? Just when you thought you knew every single thing there is to know about this game, you suddenly realize that you know absolutely nothing about this game. And let me tell you, man, that exact scenario has happened to me this year, ever since I started playing on the Kingdom Craft server. Now, let me try and explain to you why I've suddenly realized that I am indeed, even though I know some of you guys think that it's not true, I am indeed a Minecraft freaking noob. Now, I may not be a noob when it comes to the mechanics of the game, although there are some mechanics of this game that I still don't understand fully. But when it comes to crafting and building stuff, I would say that I am pretty much still a noob, and I still have a ridiculous amount to learn. Now, since I've started playing on the Kingdom Craft server, my eyes have been opened to a whole new style of crafting. And that is mostly because I have been playing a ton of Minecraft with the awesome guys on the Kingdom Craft server. And they have opened my eyes to something that I never really paid attention to in this survival series. And that little something something is called block variance. And what I mean by block variance is the following. Alternating blocks so that the textures of those blocks look really, really good together while not looking completely insane and out of place. That is a skill that I think in this game should be called variation. I think variation is a good word for it. And that is a skill that I think takes many, many years of practice to actually achieve. And I don't think that there are many Minecrafters out there who have nailed the skill of variation. And it's something that I really do want to try and start focusing on. I've been doing a lot of variation in Kingdom Craft, on the Kingdom Craft server. A lot of my new builds in the Kingdom Craft server are very different to the builds that I've created in the survival series. And I want to start bringing some of that variation philosophy into this series, because I think that we could potentially make this series even more beautiful, and we could make our brand new builds look even better. Now, let's have a quick look at what we're doing right now. We are making the second floor of this mob castle build, and it is all made out of stone brickage. And even though it looks kind of cool, it is just one big texture block of exactly the same texture, which is the stone block texture. Now, how do we start adding variance into this? Well, the problem is that in our current texture pack, which is John Smith Legacy, there are not really many blocks that fit well with this stone brick texture. Now, there are a few that we could potentially try. For example, we could try and use a little bit of slabbage every now and then, which does add a little bit of variety into the texture, doesn't it? It makes a nice, a little bit of a bigger stone in amongst these stone bricks. Actually, that works really, really nicely. I might just dot a couple of these around just to have a look at what this looks like. But as far as a variation for stone bricks is concerned, man, we do not have a lot to choose from. In the vanilla texture pack, in Minecraft Survival vanilla texture pack, a lot of stuff goes very well with stone bricks, namely cobblestone, andesite, even gravel goes really well with your vanilla stone brick texture. But in John Smith, we've got a little bit of a problem. Now, this is why, the reason that I wanted to talk about this, guys, is because I want to get some help from you guys. Actually, these slabs do add a very nice little bit of variety in here, don't they? Very, very nice. I want you guys to help me out. Those of you who are playing in the John Smith Legacy Texture Pack, I need you guys to help me out to figure out what blocks in this texture pack go really well together. What combinations of blocks that I have missed so far that I could be using to add more variation into our builds. If you guys have got some sweet ass block combinations for me and John Smith, I want you to be hitting me up in the comment section below. Right freaking now, I'm going to be reading the comment section of this video like a fiend, and I hope that you guys are going to be able to help me out. Even though I've been struggling a little bit with variating the textures of John Smith, the whole experience has actually been a positive one, guys, and let me try and explain myself why. Not being able to match colors in blocks very easily in a texture pack forces you to try and find other ways to create variance. And what I figured was that we could probably use design to try and add variance rather than just color matching variance. You know, variance is pretty easy to achieve when you have two blocks that look pretty similar to each other, because you can just place them next to each other and that creates a sort of automatic variance. But to create variance using design is much more of a challenge. And I think that I have come up with a pretty neat design for the four towers that surround the inner section of our mob castle. Check it out. I'm using cobblestone walls, iron fences, and polished andesite, along with a little bit of slabbage, to create what I think looks like a pretty decent looking tower. It's definitely much better than that janky ass stone design that we had that was literally just stone bricks all the way up. In fact, you can see the rest of it up there. It looks so plain and so boring up there, doesn't it? So check it out. I'm going to do exactly the same design on this side. This is one of the last towers that we need to finish off here. And all we're going to be doing is building what is essentially a skirting of cobblestone walls all the way up the front sides of the towers. And this kind of creates a really cool, like, Romeo and Juliet balcony, I suppose, is the best way to describe it. And also what it does is it creates a little bit of depth when it comes to the very flat sides of these towers, right? The towers are currently extremely flat, as you can see. If we take a look up there, it is just so, so boring. And adding a little bit of these cobblestone walls, along with the andesite blocks that sort of poke out from above the walls and sort of out from above that balcony, really does add a lot of depth to the tower itself. I think it looks really, really awesome. And check it out. We can even use some slabs to add a little bit more interesting depth into the corridor. And check it out. If we come all the way up here, get rid of this sucker and add our fences in between these polished andesite and add a little bit of slabbage like this, we create like a little Romeo and Juliet balcony, which I think looks really, really awesome. I'm going to take you all the way across to the other towers that I've finished. Check it out, just to show you what these balconies look like. If we come down here, you can see that this balcony is absolutely beautiful, isn't it? We have a nice little view into the first floor of the mob castle. A bit of, and this iron adds a little bit of evilness to it. It makes it feel kind of cold and kind of calculated. A killing machine of epic proportions. That is exactly what this castle is. We've got another really cool balcony over here that overlooks the passageway behind or in between the towers. And I think that works really, really well. And I'm going to be emulating this design for all four of the towers all the way up to the very top of our mob castle. But we need to have a little bit of a talk, you and I, about exactly what we're going to be doing with the remaining floors of our castle. It looks like we might be able to stick in another, what, one, two, three, four more floors into this castle. And man, that is a lot of space to work with. inside of this castle. I'm going to do a little bit more work on finishing off these towers and finishing off the interior of the first floor, and we'll come back again and we're going to have a serious discussion about what we're going to be doing with the remaining three or four floors of this mob castle. Cyber dogs and friends from all over the world, I have a confession to make, and it ain't pretty. I, Ren Dog, have been fishing in Minecraft. Oh, the shame. I know, my friends. I know. Unsubscribe now. Oh, man. But seriously, guys, I have been doing a little bit of fishing in Minecraft because, well, when I was working on this build off camera, I broke my Silk Touch pickaxe. I basically pushed it beyond its limit and I broke it, and I needed to grind this thing for an hour or so to get enough experience to get another pickaxe. I got a Silk Touch 1 efficiency 3 and an efficiency 4 unbreaking 3 diamond pickaxe. But in the process, while I was waiting for the mobs to spawn, I was fishing inside of this little pond, which was acting as the safety drop while we were working on this tower. And I wanted to show you guys a little something, actually, before we head upstairs to talk about what we're doing up there. I want to show you what I managed to fish out of this little pond. I managed to fish out an enchanted book that has Blast Protection 4 and Knockback 2. Now, isn't that a little bit strange that a weapon book has an armor enchant on it? I mean, I didn't know that you could get like an armor enchant and a weapon enchant on the same enchanted book. I don't know if that's a glitch or a bug, but I've never seen that before. I mean, this essentially means we could give one of our swords knockback 2 and blast protection 4, and that would essentially turn our sword into a piece of armor as well as a really good sword. So very kind of weird, kind of something that I wanted to show you. And let me know, guys, if you ever found a book that has like a weird dual enchant like that, or is my world just going absolutely freaking crazy? Well, it had to happen sometime, didn't it, my friends? God dang it, creeper to the butt again. Now, before you start spamming the comment section of this video with facepalm messages, I'd just like to point out, my friends, that I did in fact have armor on. I had freaking golden chestplate fire protection 2 armor on and leather pants protection 1. And that creeper still freaking killed me, man. What is up with that jazz? Creepers seem to be getting stronger and stronger as the days go by, or perhaps I'm just getting worse and worse at Minecraft, if that's even possible. But here we are, guys. I am just currently trying to finish off the interior of my mob castle without freaking dying again. Not sure if I'm going to be able to pull it off in this episode, but man, has there been a lot of dying over the last few episodes, hasn't there? I think we probably died more in the last 10 episodes than we have in the first, like, 40 episodes of season number 4, man. It's been absolutely crazy. But check it out, man. It is looking pretty freaking awesome. I managed to finish off all of the walls. So now the first floor of our mob castle is 100% complete. Looking jazz freaking tastic. Let's get a little bit of this iron fence action in here too, and I can show you guys how I finished this off. Looking awesome. And what I need to do is get a little bit of... Hold on, let me just finish this side off too. There we go. Now, what I need to do is get a little bit of dark oak wood plankage. I think that's what I use to make these little lamp post thingies. Let's have a look. Yep, the final touch to this nice little wall that separates the interior of the first floor from the outer corridor is using these really cool dark oak wood fences, which have a little bit of like wetness to them, I suppose. I don't know, they just look a little bit more evil to me than your average oak fence or spruce fence. So let's get a little bit of torch action onto these suckers to complete this side of the corridor. And look at that, man, that is looking absolutely awesome. I am loving it, man. What we need to still do though is get the wooden beams in here, and we also need to add a skirting all the way along the circumference of the first story, which is basically polished andesite with some iron fences in front. I think that looks absolutely awesome. And as you can see, I need to do that all the way on the second side of our mob castle over here. But you know what, my friends? I'm going to leave that for another day. I've been working really, really hard inside of the mob castle today. It is starting to look really, really sweet. And there's just two more things that I have time for in today's episode. Number one, I want to have a quick chat with you guys about my plans for this castle. And number two, we need to head back to the Doggolith because I need to add 8 more of you guys to the Doggolith for today. So let's head up to the second story of the Mob Castle and have a really quick chat about what I'd like to do up here and indeed on the 4 floors that we're going to be adding to the Mob Castle. Now, the original idea was to make each of the floors something different. So, like, the first floor would be a barracks, the second floor would be an armory, the fourth floor would be like a chest room potentially, and the third floor could be a prison or something like that. But what I realized is that even if we make all of those really cool floors and we make them look really super awesome, the problem is going to be that we will actually never see them again. We'll see them when we build them and it'll be all really awesome and really cool. But once they are built, we will actually never see them again. And I kind of want this mob spawning facility to be exactly that, as an efficient a mob spawning facility as possible, right? And what I figured was perhaps we could find a way to turn the floors into some dark spawning rooms. Now, I know that it's not the most efficient thing that we could potentially do. You know, if you want to make a really efficient mob spawner, what you should be doing is making the mob spawner in the sky, like way away from the overworld, so that the mobs have maximum spawn rates. But you guys know that I don't really like making those kind of builds in Minecraft. I think they're kind of ugly, and I like to make builds that are interesting, that look beautiful, even if they aren't exactly the most efficient things that you can make. So I have an idea, right? Considering we have a ton of space from the wall of the castle to the actual delivery chute area, why don't we try and make some sort of a system that is going to dispense some water like this, right? Boom. And it's going to push the mobs into a canal, which will deliver them directly into the delivery chute. So they'll get taken straight up the water chute and then taken over again to drop down to the processing facility. Now, what we could potentially use is some dispensers for this, and we could wire up those dispensers to some sort of a hopper timer of some kind, where the dispensers would be triggered every minute or so. And while we are AFK in the farm, we could turn these giant rooms into really big dark rooms, and we will get some mob spawning in them. What we could do is potentially make rows of 2 blocks wide like this, right? And the reason for that is, of course, we don't want spiders spawning up here. We only want to be spawning creepers, zombies, and skeletons. And they will be spawning in these sort of corridors here within the dark rooms that will make up the mob castle. And then every minute or so, the dispensers will trigger and they will get flushed down the stream into another chute that might deliver them into either this main chute or potentially back into that chute over here, down here. And that will make them join the main line, if you will, of mobs that are traveling along the aqueducts from the spawner that's underneath the mob castle. So that is the kind of thinking that I am having right now, guys. Let me know what you think about that idea. I think that that could work really cool. If we could get 4 big dark room spawners added to this mob spawning trap, I think that we will get a sufficient amount of mobs spawning and dropping down here that we don't have to AFK too long to get a lot of experience. And then we can start doing some enchanting and start getting some proper freaking items in our belly. But yeah, guys, I hope you enjoyed the working on the interior of the mob castle today. We'll do a little bit more work on this in the next episode. I'll probably do a little bit of work off camera also, finishing off all the grindy stuff. And I'm really looking forward to some advice from you guys about how we can start mixing up the textures in John Smith and maybe finding some different textures other than slabbage and stone bricks to make the place look a little bit more interesting. Going to be absolutely awesome, man. Cannot wait for this build to be finished. It is going to be so sweet. And speaking of sweet, it is time to get some of you guys onto the Doggolith. Wow, guys, isn't that an absolutely amazing view? The moon rising above the Nether Portal Temple with the forest behind it and the Cyberdog Monument to the left. Oh my goodness, isn't that absolutely beautiful? But welcome, my friends, to a brand new wall on the Doggolith. I cannot believe that we are on episode 51 of this Minecraft Survival Series, season number 4. completely, insanely crazy. Just want to say a big thank you to all of you guys who have been following the series and who have been enjoying it along with me. It has been so freaking awesome so far. Just cannot wait to carry on getting it on right here in Minecraft Survival. But here, guys, we are at the Doggolith for the first time in the second half of Season 4 to welcome 8 more of you subscribers of the Ren Diggity Dog channel. Please say hello to Sulrak20, CreepingZombie15, DHBloodWolf, and Bacon Pancakes. Bacon Pancakes, don't mind if I do. And of course, from Dogcraft.net, we've got Super Kirumaru, Saul Miller, The Pumpkin Project, and Fuzzy Noid. I want to welcome you all to the Doggolith. You have been immortalized in the Interbubs forever. Thank you so much for being subscribers, and thank you so much for your continuing support by hitting that like button, by sharing my videos with your friends, and generally by being awesome cyber freaking dogs. And remember, guys, if you want to get onto this Doggolith or stand a chance of being added, you need to leave me a comment on one of my videos and be a subscriber to the Ren Dog channel. I choose you guys randomly from there. You can also join Dogcraft.net, which is the free official CyberDog fan community. There's a thread there where you can leave your YouTube username to stand a chance of being added to the Doggolith. But that is pretty much all the time that we have for today, guys. Let's watch this beautiful moon rise into the sky. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. Cannot wait to see y'all in the next episode.